And we're back, ladies and gentlemen, live on the Philippe Matthews Show. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. It has taken some time to get her because she is in such demand, but she is such an awesome, awesome person and spirit and warrior in this fight called anti-racism, white superiority, white supremacy. Her name, of course, is Debby Irving. She is the author of Waking Up White, which tells the story of how she went from being well-meaning to well-doing. After attending a graduate school course, I think it was in 2009, it was entitled Racial and Cultural Identities, Debbie woke up and realized, hey, guess what? I'm white. What the heck is this about? Debby Irving, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me on, Philippe.
So I just love the title. You can see the book in the back, ladies and gentlemen. You woke up white. What happened when you had your awakening, your epiphany, because there's so much to talk about. Life before that, your family, the values, how you came to this epiphany. Walk us through a little bit of that.
Well, what happened was my entire belief system crumbled. Everything that I believed to be true about my country and my family and me got slowly what's that game where you build a tower and people take away the blocks until it was like that. I've never used that metaphor before, but that's what it was like. And what was getting taken away, I would learn a piece of history that completely contradicted my understanding. For instance, I was deeply wedded to the idea that America's playing field was level, that this was. Yeah, that was so real to me. You're having quite a reaction.
Yeah, I'm like, yeah, because it's amazing. How, one of the parts of doing this work is always putting yourself, I remember, Stephen Covey's Seven Habits of Highly Effective People decades ago. Well, put yourself in the other person's position and shoes and try to see it from their vantage point. And it's very difficult as a melanated man to hear you say that and to actually believe that there are millions of whites, millions of people in this country that actually think that there's a level playing field.
Right, and in the level playing field mindset, because I'm very intimate with it, because I lived in it so long.
Sure.
All those words like life, liberty, justice for all, and the idea of pulling yourself up by your bootstraps. It's this beautiful, romantic idea that all you have to do is work hard and you'll reach that beautiful American dream in a generation or two. And it felt real to me because I grew up in a white suburb, and I was surrounded by people who had a family story that went, my great-grandparents came here with 2 cents in their pocket. They didn't speak a word of English. They were treated like dirt. That's an important piece because they had to overcome discrimination.
Interesting.
Treated like dirt, and look at us now. Mm. And so it felt to me like if you just, kept your nose to the grindstone, anybody could make it, even through discrimination.
Even through discrimination. Sorry, I don't mean to...
Go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. Now, also the other part of that is that your great great grandfathers and mothers and family, whatever, also owned slaves. So that was a time when, it's kind of fascinating to hear folk talking about the white folk talking about their family dynamic, their ancestral dynamic, and discrimination in the same conversation. It's absolutely fascinating how the mind breaks, I guess, and has those two dynamics.
Right. Well, so what's interesting is that the family story I just described about my grandparents came here, that actually wasn't my story. But it was the story of people who had Greek, Italian, Jewish, what I now would call the white ethnic family identity. I hear this from Italian people all the time. What I did not understand from a legal or historical perspective was that all those people were able to become classified legally as white.
Yes.
That was why.
1681, the anti-miscegenation laws. Yeah.
And you couldn't buy a home in Winchester unless you were legally white. Right. You couldn't take out a loan from my neighborhood unless you were legally white. And so I didn't understand any of the laws around white, which Jacqueline Badalora, who you've had on, you know, she's a phenomenal expert on this. So without any of that context, so the whole thing about owning slaves, so my family did not own slaves, which I thought exempted me. I thought all the people in the North were the good white people and all the people in the South were the bad white people. What never occurred to me, and I had to have a graduate school professor point out to me through copious readings and data, was that there is no way to be in the North during the time of slavery and not be profiting from slavery, because the entire country was built on the economy of enslaved Africans.
Exactly.
And we're not even talking about the fact yet that the whole operation of enslaved Africans producing an economy for white people is on stolen land.
Correct.
So the layers and layers of layers of waking up white, it is not a 60-second undertaking.
Well, also, the waking up white, you know, I mean, you used a verb, you used a term called shattered. It must, walk us through, as a white woman, one of the things that you know, this work does, because there's an anger on both sides. There's an anger in the melanated community that all white people are bad and they need to pay a price and they should feel as guilty and horrible and horrific as possible. So that's one side. And there's people in between that, of course, and people who don't believe that at all. Then on the white side, there are folk that are saying, hey, you know, I'm a good person. This happened a long time ago. This has nothing to do with me. Walk us through when you had these deep-seated beliefs that were unconscious, that came to the surface and really rocked your constitution as to what it means not to just be white, but to be a human being in America.
Yeah, system was shattered. When I think about it, I think about when I was young. You know, Dr. Eddie Moore always says he was taught to hate in his most innocent state. Well, I was fed myths. I was fed myths in my most innocent state. And the myth was that this was the best country on earth. This is post-World War II, because I was born in 1960. So there's all this ideology around anybody can come here. It's a safe harbor. It's a beautiful country. Anyone can be anything they want. It's the safest country on earth. It's the best country on earth. Mm-hmm. And those weren't just ideas. Those ideas were charged with emotion, feelings of safety and glory and ego. And so when I had to break down the fact that, no, this actually was a country with an extremely violent history and a history of lying and cheating and denying, that was so counter to everything I wanted to be and identified myself as, that there was a big disconnect with how can I be an American when America's history is nothing like what I thought. Mm-hmm. And so it was really, for me, a lot of the physiological symptoms that I suffered as I went through the waking up white process were reminded me of when my father dropped dead of a pulmonary embolism and I grieved his passing. It was grief. So
wow.
I mean, it was like a cellular level paradigm shifting. Oh. So I had to figure out, who am I? Who do I want to be? And if I was taught to believe other people were inferior, which that really became apparent to me, that, you know what, if I didn't understand any of the systems or history that had been operating in my life, when I looked at a dilapidated black and brown neighborhood, or a black, or the way the black kids in my classroom as an elementary school teacher had a pattern of not thriving while the white students did, if I didn't understand the history and systems behind that, my only explanation was, well, white people must be smarter and harder working, or maybe care more about education. Mm-hmm. And when I started to investigate those ideas, I realized that there were very powerful ideas about natural order that began hundreds of years earlier that were still very much floating through the United States cultural waters, and that I had 110% bought into them.
That's a powerful level of honesty. In your TED Talk, and I know we've got a little feedback here, hopefully that will go away eventually. But anyway, in your TED Talk, you talked about being, you opened it up saying being cringe-worthy because you are talking to a group of your peers, your racial peers, white people in the audience, and you're going to be talking about waking up white. And, that, you know, we had Dr. Robin DiAngelo on who talks about white fragility, which I think is one of the most genius studies ever to really put a context and a framework to what happens when white people are faced with a racial talk and racial issues. So walk us through what is cringeworthy that you experienced during your TED Talk and doing your talks and working with white people, waking them up.
So when I think of cringeworthy in the context of my work, I think it's revealing the blunders, the things I did that were really, they're embarrassing to admit. You know, for instance, being so gung-ho to go in and save and fix those poor black and brown children and families in these neighborhoods, that's cringeworthy because I'm exposing my own level of ignorance.
Right. So you were telling me in the green room, there was, what was that? It was some, you were in an arts event or something you were doing, and you wanted to bring in inner city children. Tell us that story.
Oh, it wasn't an arts event. It was years and years of doing this. That was my job, was I was the general manager of a couple different arts organizations over the years. And I had a particular passion, regardless of the organization I was with, of raising money in order to connect the arts institution I was with to the inner city youth. There was a lot of money to be raised for the inner city youth. And so I was busing children into daytime performances. I was creating opportunities for artists to go into Boston public schools. So, because I've always been in the Boston area as an adult. What is so cringeworthy to me is that I was creating programs that the people who I was trying to support and help didn't want. But I was patting, mostly what was coming out of those was I was patting myself on the back for doing such good work. What shocks me now is that I never stop to say, why is there so much money available for inner city neighborhoods? Well, if I had asked that one simple question, I would have learned that it was reparation money from the housing, the school busing and desegregation program that had gone on in Boston and led to such violence in the 1960s. Mm-hmm. 5 miles from my home, but I didn't know about it because I was in my sheltered white suburb. So it's already in our, well, we've been 15 minutes now, you have heard me describe one disconnect after the other. I just was not making any connections.
Just the fact that there is a term called inner city children. You know, this is what we talk about when we talk about Black Lives Matter, is that, walk us through your version or awakening of institutionalized racism and white supremacy, because that's something that still has almost like, it's almost like Greek mythology to a certain segment of population, like, oh, that never happened. That must have been Zeus or someone and summoning stars, and oh, that's impossible. Walk us through that, because when we hear the term inner city children, that smacks of institutionalized racism.
It does. And then the language, of course, is code for black and brown children without having to say black and brown children. When I think about inner cities now, the first thing that comes to my mind is the GI Bill. So the GI Bill for people who, listeners who aren't familiar with it, that was, it still goes on today, but in its post-World War II iteration, the GI Bill offered returning GIs, including my father, my uncles, all the men in my neighborhood, a package of benefits when they return. They're young men, they're starting their families, the U.S. government says, hey, GIs, thanks for your service. We'd like to help you go to graduate, go get an education, go to higher, you can use the bill for higher education. So my father went to Harvard Law School for free. On the housing front, this is where we're getting back to our inner city neighborhood, the United States government GI Bill offered a government-backed mortgage so that people like my dad could buy a home with a government-secured mortgage, which had a very low interest rate. I knew my dad got the GI Bill. I knew my parents bought their first home for $17,000 on that bill in the 1940s. I knew that. What I didn't know was that the GI Bill was not available to the 1 million black GIs. 1.2 million. And by the way, did I know there were 1.2 million black GIs? No, I didn't. Because where were they in my movies and my textbooks? That's another institution. That's the media institution, whitewashing the way history goes down in this country. So I find out that there are 1.2 million black GIs, and then I find out that they were not available, the GI Bill was not available to them. It wasn't written anywhere in the GI Bill that it wasn't. It was through systemic racism. There's a whole story on higher education I could tell you about, but because we're trying to get to the inner city, on the housing front, the FHA, Federal Housing Authority, arm of our government, wrote guidelines to private banks regarding making sensible loans. And they said, look at private banks, when you're making loans for residences to private individuals, consider two factors. One, consider the condition a building is in. And that makes sense, because who wants to invest in a falling apart building? Second condition, the skin color of the residence. So written into our government guidelines.
This was written into the government guidelines, the skin color of, so the two things is the condition of the building and the skin color.
And specifically the language was the presence of even one or two non-white families can undermine real estate values.
Wow.
In the 1930s. So when that language comes to private banks, they go, holy cow, and they... Hundreds of banks across the country in the 1930s created maps of their cities and their towns and engaged in a practice now referred to as redlining. So they outlined in red neighborhoods that were exclusively black, brown. Never going to make a loan there. They outlined in dark green neighborhoods that were exclusively white. That's a safe place to make a loan. And then there were two other gradations, something green, yellow, these middle areas kind of change. But they have to do with, you know, one is still okay, kind of, and the other one is definitely declining, which you know means that the black people are moving in.
Mm-hmm.
So the GI Bill-backed loans were only good in those dark green outlined areas, which means they were only available to white people moving into white neighborhoods. So what that means is that those redlined areas got castrated economically.
Absolutely.
I know this is only one moment in time. So it's an
Well, no, because here's, when we, you know, I do a lot of work in epigenetics and intergenerational, how your environment actually can change and alter your, and affect your DNA. When we talk about the term white privilege, and we can have this conversation, and I had Richard Rothstein, who is a researcher for the Economic Research Institute, did a 40-page paper called The Making of Ferguson, which outlined exactly what you just talked about, and how ghettos, poverty and academic castration and economic castration of melanated people was created and was law at both federal and state levels. Talk to us then about the fact that this is in the 30s and 40s, the fact that you can't buy a house in the way, and even if you have the money, you can't buy the house that you want. Even if the money was given to you by the GI Bill, you can't get it. you can't move in. So you're forced to move into a neighborhood that does not have and will not appreciate, have property value. You can't pass that on generationally to your family and create what's known as generational wealth. Walk us through this, because this is something that I think people, both sides really need to understand what happened and how we got here. And when we see some of our young melanated people acting up and acting out, and wondering why they're not educated, why they don't have a affinity for education, why they have no economic footing, is because there's an intergenerational component to this. Debbie, please.
Well, I mentioned that my parents bought their home, for instance, for $17,000 in Winchester.
Mm-hmm.
They sold that home 40 years later for $1 million.
Wow. Wow.
Okay, so in addition,
let's just pause for him. Hold on, I need some water.
And don't get out your calculator, then you'll be breaking out
your mind. I don't want to do that, but my gosh, if you know, and you're looking at 1.2 million African men who came back from the war, who fought for this country, had that opportunity. Where would we be today?
Well, yeah, and okay, to give you a sense of scale, the GI Bill pumped $120 billion into private housing. $120 billion in 140s dollars. I can't do the time value crunch on that right now, but you know, that would be a much bigger number now.
Sure.
$120 billion into the hands of white families.
Wow.
Only there were 4% of black GIs who were able to get these benefits. The one person I have met who was able to was a professor, and his university underwrote the loan. So there were a couple exceptions, but we're talking exceptions. This is a massive pattern. And so we're talking about the accumulation of financial wealth. We're not even talking now about the fact that my father went to Harvard Law School and graduated without any loans. So now he's got that. So he's living in Winchester, where he, my mom, and all of us are building all this social capital with all these other people who have had free higher education, who are building wealth through their white homes. And the exact opposite, you know, we're snowballing in the right direction. It's compounding in the other direction for black and brown people. And now we can move away from just material advantage and disadvantage. And we can talk about psychological. We can talk about health, like you were referring to. So the food in my town was superior. The transportation in my town was superior. The education in my town was far superior, because where do education budgets come from in this country? Property tax. So the compounding across multiple systems of advantage and disadvantage, just from that one decision of putting into the FHA guidelines that skin color mattered, that one decision has created such unbelievable, devastating racial mythology, differential psychological outcome, differential health outcome, differential material outcome, and the whole thing is explained away as black and brown people are the problem.
Mm-hmm.
When this is a white designed system.
Well, now let's talk about the white design system. Let's talk about, you talk about this in the book, classism versus racism, or class versus race. We have recently heard the term that has become a meme, you know, the 1%. We can easily say that that 1% is what created the anti-miscegenation laws and created white supremacy in this country as a whole. We can also say that that 1% of elite white males, particularly white males, and you know, at some point subsequently the white females, that they it's a system that almost collapses unto itself, because everything is based on a lie. And when you woke up one day realizing you were white, it shattered your entire paradigm of what America is and what we fight for. talk to us about, and I know some people don't like this, but I have to because that's just who I am. Talk to us about the damage this is doing and has done, not just to us melanated people, but to whites.
I touch on this in the book, but I've explored this much more deeply since the book came out, is the idea of the cultural. So white supremacy, I almost used the word offers, imposes upon us a social arrangement in which some people are more valued than others. Some people have more access to rights, resources, respect, representation than others. Historically, the group that has had the most access has been white, male, as you mentioned, also Christian, also appearing to be heterosexual, also appearing to be able body, sound mind. The list goes on a little bit there. So my phone is ringing, which is distracting me.
That's okay. We don't hear it.
So there's this arrangement in terms of who's more or less valuable and who these resources go to disproportionately. The arrangement also includes some rules of engagement. So there's a culture. That rules of engagement and culture for me are part and parcel of the same thing. There are rules of engagement that actually hold the whole arrangement in place. Some of the cornerstone rules of engagement are fear of conflict or conflict avoidance. So everybody knows in this culture what the consequences are to engage in conflict. There's a lot at stake. You might not be promoted. You might not be invited to the office social. You might not be invited back to a certain person's home. So there's this value of complying. That is one cultural norm. And another one is what Robin DiAngelo talks about the fallout of, which is emotional restraint. So emotions are seen as weak. Crying, you know, when women cry, if a man cries, it's seen as a weakness. It's also seen as a weakness in my culture growing up, which was a New England WASP upper class culture. Anger was seen as a weakness. It was seen as it was being poorly raised or actually a character flaw. So now if we live in a culture where you have to comply, the value is on complying, not critiquing or engaging in conflict, and any sign of anger or sadness is seen as a weakness, that creates a culture of silence. And in silence comes information vacuums in which ignorance breeds and rebeats and myths get produced. And I would argue that what hurts all of us, these norms of conflict avoidance and emotional restraint, those hurt everybody in our personal relationships. If we were better at just those two things, we wouldn't be emotionally fragile the way Robin says. You know, white people would be much less emotionally fragile and would get the skills that we need to navigate conflict. Well, both of those things make you a better partner, a better parent, a better child, a better sibling, a better friend, and a better community member, and a better employee, and a better employer. So there's some basic life skills that I feel, and emotional stamina that atrophied in me, that I didn't need to develop because I was from a group that was particularly powered and privileged, both, you know, racially, class-wise, religiously. You know, I'm Christian, I'm heterosexual, I'm all of those privileges. And so I didn't have to struggle much.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about that as it relates to white privilege. How does I guess the anti-miscegenation laws, the law of naturalization of having to be white to be a member, to be naturalized and be a member of America, which didn't come off the books until 1952. So you can imagine the epigenetic fallout on that. We're living it right now in this day and age. Walk us through how white privilege affects other races, other ethnicities, as it relates to just what happened recently in Orlando.
So in the Orlando story, I see white privilege and I see heterosexual privilege. And I see probably ethnic privilege in there too. So Anglo is the normalized, you know, white is the normalized race. Heterosexual is the normalized sexual orientation. Anglo is the normalized ethnicity in this country. We follow Anglo culture. We're not celebrating. We are starting to add other ethnicities holidays to our schools and workplaces, for instance, but that's just an example. So when I read about what the experience is, and sadly I'm learning this now, I didn't understand how it was important. It was for people of a Latino queer identity to gather, to dance together, because dance is such an important piece of the Latino culture, mm-hmm. and yet queer is still a difficult idea in Latino circles. So to be able to be together in that way is a racial, ethnic, and sexual orientation constellation that's unique. And everybody in the world wants to be able to go somewhere where they can let down and thrive and just be themselves on a weekend night, don't they? Mm-hmm. Now, as a white person, as a heterosexual person, and as an Anglo person, I don't have to think about seeking out spaces where I can let down my guard and just be myself. Those places abound for me. So one thing is, I don't have to think about it. And when 50 people, or 49, whatever the final number was, are murdered, and more, physically injured, and how many more psychologically damaged, and how many more who weren't even in that state mm-hmm. are traumatized because there's been an assault on their constellation of identities. So I'm spared all of that. I don't have to know it. I don't have to know how much it hurt. I don't have to know what I can do to step in and be an ally. So in that way, that's one white privilege is white. I mean, I mentioned multiple intersection of mm-hmm. privileges.
In the book, you talk about the Robin Hood syndrome. Connect the dots with me. What is the Robin Hood syndrome?
Well, a lot of people call it the white savior syndrome. And it's what I referred to before about going into neighborhoods and wanting to help and fix.
Right.
And this is, a lot of white liberals, which I was definitely always a white liberal, I would say, it's this, I'm a good person. Isn't that enough? I actually have a public presentation called I'm a Good Person, Isn't That Enough? Because it's such a prevalent feeling. And you think, well, how could you possibly criticize me for going in and doing that? What I didn't realize when the reason I say Robin Hood syndrome is because I had access to wealth. I could pick up the phone and call people who were in corporations or had family foundations. I could raise so much money so quickly for these inner city programs. And I thought I was a fantastic fundraiser. Never occurred to me that it wasn't just me, that it was my social capital and my connection. So I felt like, yet in that white savior mindset, I felt like I was stealing from or borrowing or taking from the rich to give to the poor.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So that's where the Robin Hood comes in. I didn't see that there was a white savior complex within it. I also think it's important when talking about the white savior complex to connect the historical image of Manifest Destiny, the white woman. There's a painting of a white woman floating over the plains. I don't know if you're familiar with that painting. And that is a painting that goes along with the time in history where westward expansion was happening. Mm-hmm. And Manifest Destiny was the language given to the prevailing narrative that it was okay, not only was it okay, that it was that white people were God's chosen mm-hmm. people. They were the best people. And it was their moral duty and their Christian obligation to spread all their goodness all the way westward to the Pacific coast. And it justified the Mexican-American War, in which a huge chunk of land suddenly became named Texas, and all the people living on it were suddenly U.S. subjects. Mm-hmm. And it justified the displacement of all the indigenous people along the way, separating children from their parents and putting them in Indian boarding schools where they got their tongues cut if they spoke English, where they were scrubbed down with kerosene and lye, where they had their clothing removed and their hair cut off, and they were given Anglo clothing and an Anglo name and a little Bible so that they could be Christianized. So this idea of a white person going in to help and fix is so charged with this history of brutal deculturalization, taking away someone's culture and saying, here, my culture is the right one. My religion is the right one. My way is the right way. And I'm going to help you be more like me.
Mm-hmm. Well, we also see that in our foreign affairs, do we not?
We sure do.
Yeah. I had John, I don't know if you know John Perkins. Wrote the book Economic Hitman. He was a CIA operative years ago, and it talks about how he would go to various different developing countries, and pretty much put the country, talk to the prime minister, the president of the country, and put them in a position of debt that they could never repay, and then they have to live under American policy, which is the same policy that we are living under right now, and that created slavery, that created this conversation, and it's a very hard conversation because American policy, one might say, has created terrorism, or at least has fueled it. When we look at when we talk about democracy. And we use these nice big words, and then as an umbrella, and then underneath that comes all of what you just shared with us. Talk to us about how the media, when we talk about Robin Hood syndrome and the white savior, talk to us about growing up white and all of the stories, all the mega media stories from Santa Claus on down were all white. Saviors,
right? Jesus too.
Yep, being white. That guy. Yeah.
The first time I heard someone say, "Ha, that Jesus is white," I was like, "Of course he is." or the first time.
I love your honesty, Debbie. This is great.
The first time someone told me that Santa Claus was a Greek myth, I was like, no, he lives in the North Pole. Before I caught myself saying, wait, the North Pole isn't even a real place. Like, when you ingest these myths so often at such a young age, they are as real can be. Mm-hmm. So those were really hard parts of the myth. And it's funny, I hadn't made the connection about them being charitable, but they are charitable. And what's interesting about both of them, by the way, is they reward you if you're good, and right. Only if you're good, right?
That's right.
I haven't thought about that till right now. When I think about charity, I think about, my family had a deep belief that to whom much is given, much is expected. And that was a phrase that we used. And it meant that it was important for those of us who had wealth and to give back what was never talked about or investigated. And my parents aren't alive for me to explore any of this waking up stuff with. To what degree did they understand how tarnished what they had was? Mm-hmm. Did they think it was completely fairly earned as I did? Did they believe in the myth of meritocracy? Or did they understand to whom much is given? Everything we'd been gotten, is that even an English word? Everything we had gotten Yes, it came through hard work, but it came through hard work with this massive tailwind of systems designed in our favor.
You are a member of the White Privilege Conference. You have spoken there for many, many years. I have come to realize it is one of the most transformative conferences on the subject of white supremacy, white privilege. And we've had Dr. Eddie Moore Jr. On the show. Talk to us about the work that you're doing with White Privilege Conference, as well as in diversity, anti-racism in general. Why are you so passionate about this, Debbie? Because you could have just woke up white and say, okay, damn it, I'm white now. All right, I'm sorry. Great, let's move on. Let's go to Whole Foods and have, you know, have a good time. You decided to make this an entire career. Why?
Because at the same time I was ingesting all those ideas about the level playing field, I was ingesting ideals about fairness. And those remain in me. I do believe, even if the playing field isn't level, I still believe in democratic ideals. I really do believe all people are created equal, even though deep down I was doing this inferior, superior thing. What's happened now is my deep beliefs have been broken down so that I'm able to fully own my conscious beliefs. And it became clear to me that there are only two ways to go. We either live in a country designed by and for white people, or we live, to use a phrase I love from Jeff Duncan Andrade, who's an educator, so it's either white supremacy or it's a pluralistic, multicultural democracy. There's nothing in between. And I vote for the pluralistic, multicultural democracy. That's where I think America unleashes its potential. Mm-hmm. So for me, racial justice isn't the end game. The reason I would love to see white supremacist systems dismantled, and I would like to see racial justice, sexual orientation justice, class justice, all of these justices, is because then we can really see what we're made of. Then we can really unleash potential where people are thriving, not fighting with each other, but collaborating with each other. Mm-hmm. That's what gets me out of bed every morning.
Talk to me about White Privilege Conference.
Oh my God. So I have one little anecdote, which I think is the best descriptor I have of the conference yet. The year that Trayvon Martin was shot and killed, I believe that was a February, the White Privilege Conference gathers every March or April. So it was April that year, and Dr. Eddie Moore Jr., black man who founded the conference 18 years ago, he gets up onto the stage. Now, back off for a minute. Do you remember how the internet was just crawling with people in hoodies saying, I am Trayvon? Mm-hmm. Including a lot of white people. Mm-hmm. So he gets up on stage that year, as he always does, to kick off the conference, and he's wearing a big hoodie that says, I am Trayvon. He's got the hood up over his head. And 2,500 people are stomping their feet and, you know, clapping, and he says, I am Trayvon, right? And everyone goes, yeah, I am Trayvon, right? Yeah. And then he puts in this huge pregnant pause. And he says, and he pulls off the hoodie and he says, how come we're not here saying I am George Zimmerman? Who in this room is willing to look at the white supremacist within yourself? Mm. We're all so willing to point the finger at someone else, but what I want you to do, this is him talking, what I want you to do over the next 4 days is really investigate the degree to which you have bought into and maybe acting out some of this stuff yourself. Because if we don't deal with it in here, how can we deal with it in our institutions? That really sums up the heart and soul of who Dr. Moore is and what that conference is about. It's very challenging, which is needed in this work. It's not the diversity and inclusion conference.
Yeah. That's really deep work. Where do you go now? Where do we go now? What is the narrative? What is the message? Is there a way to level this playing field? Is there a way to make up for, if you will, lost time? How do we make it right?
I think the longer we go on, the harder it is. And I would never, you know, Dr. Moore and I differ on this. He feels like the best we can do is understand the system that we live in so it doesn't eat us alive. So, you know, we especially the word you keep using, I'm fascinated by, melatonated.
Melanated, yes. We don't like the, you know, part of this is the labeling, you know, and melanated is unique to people of color. It's melanin. It's what causes this color of skin. And black is a label just as white was, and we don't like it. some of us, I mean, you know, but I mean, we went from what, Negro, we know what the first one was, but we went from Negro to colored, now we're black, you know, and it's like, okay, who the hell gets to define? No. So we take it back. We're melanated.
I love the term. And now I've forgotten where I was. I was talking about
more understanding versus your paradigm.
Yeah. So and we work a lot together. So his feeling is you've just got to know melanated people. You need to know the system you're living in so it doesn't eat you alive. And you don't internalize all this stuff that you're less than, that you're this, that you're that. I really still am fighting to dismantle these structures. And so is it possible? I'm not sure. I'm sure not in my lifetime. I've got, what, 30 years left at best? I'm sure it won't happen in my lifetime, but I would never stop working towards that goal personally. So, and I will say it's in every system. There is not a school, there is not a city, there is not a hospital, there is not a grocery store. It's everywhere. It shows up. And so what's the way forward? For me, I think education is the right form of activism for me, because education is what woke me up. Mm-hmm. If it doesn't matter what color you are, if you don't understand the context that you're living in or the problems that you're living in, you can't possibly be a part of solving them.
Well, so, the other question then is, what if I don't want to be? What if I don't want to, if I'm white, what if I don't want to? I enjoy being white. I don't I really want to associate with those people over there. I am absolutely happy living in my all white world, my neighborhood, what have you. I am a Republican. I'm going to vote for Trump. I think we need to make America great again, which means go back to some of the laws of the 50s. I think that there should be Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. I believe that you should be a Christian, and you know, there, you know, I'm just happy to be in the way that I am. How do we penetrate that mindset?
Well, first of all, Dr. Moore would say you're a pancake that can't be flipped.
I never heard that term. Okay. A pancake that can never be flipped. I'm going to have to call him and say, where did you get that from, Doc? Okay.
Yeah. He's full of those things. and he was, Debbie, those people aren't worth your time. So let's say you're my uncle, though. You're in my family. I'm going to invest some time in you. How do we penetrate that mindset? I would start by asking you questions and really finding out, you know, where do you get those beliefs? So I would not make my first attempt one at trying to convince you of anything. I would just really and very authentically want to hear what you believe and where you got these beliefs. Mm-hmm. Eventually, where I'd want to go with you is I'd want to help you make some connections about how there is no scenario where it is possible for some people in a group to thrive when others are withering, mm-hmm, and dying, that the entire system has to be stabilized for anyone to be thriving. And so to think that you can sit in your armchair, white man, and sit back and reap whatever it is you think you're reaping while the country's being bogged down by people who can't work because they're incarcerated, who can't be productive citizens because they are so depressed by the degree to which they've been marginalized. They haven't gotten properly educated. And this cuts across, by the way, this is not just race, this is class. When you do not set your citizens up for success, you don't set your country up for success. So ultimately, I would try to make that argument to this person, but not until three or four conversations where I really tried to figure out where this person was coming from and built some trust.
Thank you for that. Debby, you have to come back because there are a lot of conversations we need to have about this, and I want to have all of the subtleties and the nuances with you. You are absolutely awesome, and I'm so happy that you woke up white.
Thank you. I'm so happy you had me on your show.
All right, stick around with me in the green room as we sign off. Ladies and gentlemen, Debby Irving, the book is called Waking Up White. It's an amazing book. Get it, download it, absorb it. Watch her TED Talk, where you will understand what it means to be cringeworthy. Debby, how can people get in contact with you? What's your web address?
It's debbyirving.com. Debbie's with a Y. Irving's with an I. And my book is now out on audiobooks, too.
Oh, fantastic. So we can listen to it as well as read it if we so choose to do so. Wonderful. Excellent. All right, everybody. Take care. We'll see you next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live.